Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It is a misty, eerie, and dense morning. And by dense, I mean atmosphere. Surround us here on Djuma Private Game Reserve, part of the largest Sabi Sands Game Reserve, part of the larger Greater Kruger National Park, part of the larger Greater Limpopo Trans Frontier Park. 3.5 million hectares of wonderful wilderness, 8 million acres.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It is a misty, eerie, and dense morning. And by dense, I mean the atmosphere that surrounds us here on Djuma Private Game Reserve, part of the larger Sabi Sands Game Reserve, part of the larger Greater Kruger National Park, part of the larger Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. 3.5 million hectares of wonderful wilderness, 8 million acres. You are most welcome, and it's very good to have you along for the ride. You are watching a live game drive. Wherever you are in the world, you are being transported vicariously here to the wilds of Africa, where we're going to take you on a live dawn safari. Please talk to us if you would like to. Hashtag Safari Live if you're on the tweet, or questions at wildearth.tv as we drive around on this Sunday morning and see what the wonders of Africa have to provide us today. My name is James Hendry. On camera today we have got Andrew. Andrew is dressed in an array of sort of different colors. Today, unusually, he has exposed his face to the elements. Normally he dresses like a bank robber, but today he looks like a almost normal human being. On the other vehicle, we have the irascible Brent Leo Smith, who was champing at the bit like a horse after a bucket of oats. And filming him is the diminutive Wium Druen Brach. And then in the final control room, we have got Tara Dales and the red and fiery hair of Miss Kirsty McLennan Smith. You are most welcome, like I say to you. My plan today, I'm not sure if you were with us yesterday, but if you were, you will know that a buffalo met its end at the hands of, or the paws and claws, more than hands, of five male lions just over there. Now, we've been back to check the carcass, and there are no lions there. We did hear the hyenas chattering away at the carcass about probably 4 o'clock this morning, but they seem to have moved off as well. And Andrew did spot the lion tracks heading south down the road over there. Now, we did hear them calling, but quite a long way away, I think. And if, for those of you who watch the Djuma Dam cam, you would have noticed the lions around this dam during the course of the evening, calling and calling and calling that incredibly powerful African sound of the roar of the lion. So that's the plan this morning. Just a quick note on yesterday's game drive. You will have noticed, some of you, that a few of us ended up in the dam just over there. Now, that is because we were flying a drone, which is another sort of attempt to create different content for this show, and the drone produced some very nice content before it dived headfirst into that pond. There's not a lot of water left, but the drone managed to find the only piece of water basically on Djuma, drowned itself, and is no longer functional, and that is what we were doing, trying to fish it out yesterday. I must say that I am now totally used to the feeling of catfish on my hands and feet, so I no longer make unmanly squeals every time a large catfish flies into me or bites me on the leg. Okay, that is the plan this morning. We're going to head down south, see if we can find the lions again, those five big males. Maybe there'll be some other stuff, but we'll find out as we go. You're welcome. Lovely to have you along. It's a sort of warmish 15 degrees Celsius, apparently, which I think is sits at about 65 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay. Andrew, are you ready?
Ready.
Marvelous.
Let's go.
Wave to the dam cam. Go. It feels quite misty and looks quite misty, but I don't know if this is actually a cloud that's hanging over us or if it's sort of a perch, like it's going to stay too long. Although I can't see the sun coming up through it. I think it'll be a beautiful sunrise. I'm just going to get a quick update on the radio to find out if anybody else is driving. Good morning, mobile stations. Copy, thank you. Very nice update from some of you. Apparently there was a hippopotamus trying to find some sort of something there in the Gari Dam this morning. Thank you very much for that update, or sometime during the night last night. It was very fascinating to hear that there was some hippo there. I don't know why there would have been. And that's KG in Australia, who managed to spot us that hippo. Now the tracks, Andrew, seem to have already disappeared. I heard them calling so far south, but I'm not going to worry too much about where the tracks are now. I think we're just going to go straight south and see what we can find. No tracks on the road at the moment. There they are. Going down the road. I'm not going to try and show you the tracks now. With this light so flat, we won't get some very, very good definition on it on the camera, I'm afraid. Only one lion going south on this road though. Keep an eye out. Apparently, in that Birmingham 5, there is one that tends to keep to himself a bit. He looks apparently a bit older than the others. It's not here anymore. I hope we haven't driven past him. He's still going straight down this road. Difficult to see the tracks, like I say, in this light. The best time is at dawn or dusk, when the angle of the sun is quite low, and so the tracks almost cast a bit of a shadow. That really does help. Tracking from a vehicle, of course, is never a particularly easy thing to do. A bit easier on foot. But these lions move such distances that if they're not moving in an obvious place and you don't have an incredible tracking skill, to walk at the same speed that they are moving, i.e. to keep up with them, is almost impossible. He's still on the road here. Only one. There's a nyala. Another nyala. So the idea is not to stop too much before we've got the sort of initial tracking out of the way, because the lions will move, and as I'm sure most of you know, they will then go fairly static for the rest of the day. So as soon as it gets vaguely warm, they will lie down under a tree and do not very much at all. But the idea is to do the sort of major tracking at this time of the early morning. Driving along, hoping to spot this lion. And fascinating comment from Miss Jin. Thank you. Have I got all the mud out of my toenails after my excursion into the Gowrie Dam last night? Miss Jin, I will be retrieving mud from various parts of my body, I suspect, for the best part of the next month. So, no, I haven't got it all out yet. We're hoping. Not here anymore, Andrew. Once the road gets a bit windy, the lion may have just decided to cut straight through. There's a male leopard on the road though. We're just near where quarantine was found. His tracks are right here. See that, Andrew? Quarantine's tracks going straight down the road. So he's left the kill. I'm just going to call this in because I know there's somebody going to try and look for him. Tracks of male leopard on Twin Dams Road heading south, basically from the kill site from yesterday. I'm pretty sure it's quarantine going south down the road. These look very nice tracks. No negative licks, just the tracks. Just going to look around here. So a very good question, and one which I was asking myself while we just checked to see where quarantine's tracks have gone. Andrew, I think he's around here. We need to keep our eyes wide open. Nancy, Angie and Lucy, great question about why the lions would leave the kill when there's still meat on it. Please excuse my lack of looking at you, I'm just going to keep looking at the ground to see if I can spot some tracks. The reason they would is because they, first of all, have killed fairly recently before. They have eaten most of the good stuff from that kill. And the second reason, of course, is that they're still trying to take over this territory, which means that they're not going to sit around in one place for too long. They're going to move around, roaring away and trying to establish themselves in the territory before. So, you know, and try and make sure that no other lions are able to get into the area. I'm just going to jump out of the car and have a look and see where these tracks have gone. We're going to head across to Brent and get an idea of his plan this morning, and I'll see you just now.
Good morning and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Brent Smith. I'm going to be one of your guides for the next 3 hours, and we have Wium on camera. So we're in this position where quarantine was last night. We saw a little, tiny bit of meat left in the tree. You can't see it from this side, but unfortunately, it looks like he has departed. And I just heard on the Game Drive channel that James has got his tracks heading south, to the south of us. So we're going to get moving and try find where he's gone. And it looks like our catter day is over and Sunday is here. And we've got to work for our animals this morning, but that's also fine. Also, for those of you who might be new, we are live with no leopards and lions right now, but hopefully we can rectify that shortly. And apart from being live, we also are interactive, so you are able to ask us questions about what we're doing out in the bush. You can do that by emailing us on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Well, let's go see if we can find this young male leopard who's obviously finished that diker. I was wrong yesterday. I suspected it would take him to about midday to finish it. Obviously, he got hungry during the night, and he has inhaled that diker, so he definitely wouldn't have gone for a drink because of the lions up towards the Djuma Waterhole. Maybe he's headed for a drink towards Treehouse or Twin Dams Waterhole. So let's go have a look. Misty morning. As much as I love the misty mornings, our cameramen don't as much. It's a constant battle to keep the lens clean so that condensation fogs it up. But don't worry, them is on top of it here, and he will be making sure you have the best picture possible. Make our way out of this drainage line and try to get out onto the road again and see what we can find. So I know James is on those tracks, so we're probably going to try jump ahead of James to see if that animal's gone a bit further. And of course, I would never want to be accused of stalking or following James. That's what he does to me. Oh, there's a big hole. Everyone else goes the really long way around. I've got my nice shortcuts through different areas. And the reason I know about said shortcuts is because I've done a lot of work in this area. And that really makes a big difference when you come to off-roading, to know where and where you can't cross. And I have actually crossed in this exact spot quite a few times. Hold on, I'm gonna need a little bit of speed to ascend the sandy bank. Wium, you there? Every time I tell Wium I might lose him, he just tells me to try harder. So maybe today will be the day I try hard enough. Not enough speed. Unfortunately, our difflock seems not to be engaging. Sorry about the dust. Okay. We're gonna change the angle slightly. Try climb up on the harder ground where there's not as much sand. There we go. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. So guys, we're gonna be on the Game Drive channel for a second. Morning, Lex. James and I are mobile. No animals on the last position of that buffalo knock. Also, the quarantine has finished. The diker tracks of them heading south on Twin Downs. there, Wium. There we go. One of the wonderful things about these little short vehicles that we drive on the live safaris is it enables us to get into areas that other vehicles can't. And the reason it's being short wheel based, we're able to sneak between two trees like we just did, which some of the longer vehicles are not able to. More civilized mode of transport, the road. Okay, so James said he had tracks somewhere around here. I'm just going to call him on the radio to find out exactly where. James. James, I am on Twin Dams at the moment, just past Chelepan. Where would you like me to check? Just ahead, we can actually see James, who is following Quarantine's tracks at the moment. Should we sneak up on him? Should we sneak up on him and give him a bit of a fright? Well, I don't think James would get the fright. I think Andrew would get the fright. Let's change gear. James, and as you can see, he's looking at these tracks that are running down here, and there we go. And you can see reversing takes concentration, and we can have a look. Just if we look down to the side here, there are the leopard tracks that have left what little remnants there are of that dike here. There we go. So we're not going to both drive down the same road. That would defeat the purpose of following tracks. So we're going to leave James on the tracks. And what we're going to do is we're going to go back and up another road and try leapfrog to see if it's the animal's maybe gone south or has possibly even continued further to the southwest. So we're going to head back and go on Weaver's Nest, which runs parallel to this. And obviously that's to give ourselves the best chance of finding these tracks. I'll find an animal.
Hello! Again?
Weren't you supposed to be tracking lions?
Well, they were coming down the same road.
I'm just checking.
Lions
disappeared. So, we've got a chance of finding both lion and leopard tracks. And
well, I'll go straight down to Twin Dam's dust bowl and see what's there.
Okay, so James is going to go straight down Twin Dams. We're going to head back up and do Weaver's Nest, which is the road that's parallel to this. And if there's nothing there, then we will head further to the east and see if that animal's gone back into the Mawati drainage. Bye, Andrew. Thank you very much, Julia. My mother did tell me not to leave home with wet hair. I unfortunately did not listen. Listening is possibly not one of my strong points. And a lot of preemptive and early happy birthdays out there. So thanks very much, guys. My birthday's only tomorrow, but I do appreciate all the early birthday sentiment. Just seen a Commander Bond standing next to the vehicle, losing lion tracks and finding our leopard tracks. We're going to cross back to him so he can give you. An update on what he's doing, and that'll also give Wium and I a chance to speed around to the area we think the tracks might come out. So we will be back with you a little later, but go have some fun with James.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Wendy. Well, you just saw us on Jigger really, but now you're on board with Wendy. The leopard tracks have disappeared, so I'm going to leave Brent on them. The lion tracks are back on the road here. Now there are tracks of at least two of them. Going due south, I suspect, unfortunately, that they have disappeared south of the reserve. And we have that lovely question about why they weren't at the carcass anymore when there is a little bit of meat left. And that definitely has got something to do with the fact that they are marking territory. They're looking all the time to expand their range. And these tracks are not the tracks of a lion taking a gentle stroll. They're the tracks of, what is that, the dike? They're the tracks of a lion on the march for territory. You can see that they're just moving in a dead straight line, and they were calling last night progressively further and further south. So unless they've decided to, for some reason, stop here at Twin Dams, which I don't think they will have, I think we're on a fool's errand here. Go ahead. Copy that. I've got one male going south here, tracks on Twin Dams. So Brent's got two others of them just down there, also going south. Lots of tracks all over the place. Let's see if they cross out or if they're still within range. Interesting one. There are five, in case perhaps you have just joined us. There are five male lions in this little coalition of, well, it's a large coalition, called the Birmingham Boys. And basically, Valerie, your question is, will they stay together? And the answer is yes, for a while. Then I think once they've established themselves, they'll probably split into two and three. And that split won't be an antagonistic split. It will simply be a function of the fact that it's easier to maintain their territory if they are in a sort of split group. And that often happens with these large coalitions of lions, that they will split up into small groups and maintain. And then if there's a real challenge to their authority, then they'll come together again. They call and they come together. We just need to check along the road here to see if they've crossed out. Andrew, do you see anything? Yep, there they go.
Okay.
Schwambile. Going in there?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm afraid they've gone south. So what we're going to do is return. That doesn't look necessarily like a big male though. Jump out quickly and have a look. I'll try and show you. Andrew's it. You're not going to be able to see anything there, are you? I'll just go back a bit so that you can see. Will that work at all? Yeah, that might work. Okay. Let me show you what I mean. Probably the best one that we're going to get. Andrew, can you see it at all?
Not really.
Not really. So there is the track. There are the back pads. 1, 2, 3. And the front toes. Heading due south into Hoffman's, I think it's called. So that lion is not going to be viewed by us this morning. I'm sure it'll come back at some stage, but not this morning. So we're going to go back up Twin Dams, find where the leopard tracks left the road, and then carry on from there. I'm just going to tell Brent that this lion's gone south. Brent, tracks of this male lion I was following have gone south across the border, Twin Dams. Beautiful morning. Okay, copy. Do you want me to check anywhere? I shouldn't just carry on. Copy, I'll check the rest of the southern boundary. What we're going to do is just check along the southern boundary here, just to check if the ones that Brent is following haven't crossed south as well. Moment they haven't, and they've turned from going south towards the Treehouse Dam, which is quite nice. Perchance we will be lucky, well, one of us will, and therefore you will. Beautiful morning. There are robins calling. The mist isn't sort of lifting very enthusiastically, and we certainly haven't seen the sun yet. I suppose as we move towards summer and the springtime, so the air will start to become more laden with moisture. That doesn't mean, though, that it's going to rain necessarily. And as I've told a few of you before, well, I've told everybody, we have a sort of bet on as to when it's going to rain. And Brent and I both think it's going to rain in probably in fairly late November. We have some eternal optimists who think September. That's Andrew, he's fist pumping. And there are others who think it will be October. I suspect November. And by rain, we don't mean the odd splatter. We mean a good, proper, decent storm. No tracks coming south yet. Now what's interesting, apparently, like I said to you, is that apparently one of those Birmingham boys, I think you are misting up a bit. Sorry about that. It suddenly got quite warm, and so the water is condensing on the chilly lens. road, nothing coming across. So what's interesting is that in a coalition like these five, they're obviously not all brothers. They're different sizes, and they're different shapes in some respects, with different kinds of manes. And so that does mean that they won't necessarily stick together all the time. And they do seem to have a slightly older one. He was either being ostracized slightly, or he's choosing to spend more time on his own. And that's not unusual. Buffalo tracks, you can see. Buffalo walking across the road. They don't seem to be running with a great hurry. It's now getting very eerily misty, hey? It's wonderful. It'd be lovely to find the lions walking out of the mist this morning. Suddenly got quite stickily warm, eh, Andrew?
Mm.
It's odd. The temperature's gone up by about 5 degrees. And it's got quite sort of sticky. That's Andrew's very special lens cloth, everyone. Impalas, have you seen any lions? Have you seen any lions? No? Report is telling us it's 17 degrees, but I don't think it's, it might be a little bit warmer than that, but it's very sticky, muddy. Feels like a sort of hot coastal day. Going to quickly talk to Tex on the radio. Go ahead. Tex, we've got tracks of male leopard leaving the kill site, going south in Twin Dams, and then west along Treehouse. Brent's following up there. I'm checking the southern boundary. There are tracks of one male lion heading south across the boundary. Brent has tracks of the others also on Treehouse. And I'm just checking to see whether they're cross south. They haven't as yet. I'm about to come to Shibamwe. Yeah, if I'm doing Brent check, there is still some left. But there's nothing there. Negative, nothing. So the hyenas, I don't know why, I think the hyenas will come back to that buffalo at various stages until that carcass is properly finished, but there will also be lots of vultures there too. No, negative, no one's checked that. So I've just given him an update. He said, did anyone check the hyena den? And the answer is no, not today. But we may go back there just now and have a quick look. Now come quite a long way to the west, and the tracks haven't come across south, so that is a very good sign, unless they've decided to head on to Arethusa to see if they can take that territory too, which of course used to be part of the Matimba territory. And just to the south of us yesterday, there were three male lions calling. Got Brent on the radio. Go, Brent. And says he can hear the lions.
Halfway between the line and the
Okay, copy, I'll check.
They've stopped calling now.
We're going to drive quite quickly along. He says he reckons they're probably to the west of us here. Copy, I'm at a junction or something around in Shibam now. I'll keep you posted. See if the leopard hasn't crossed out. The leopard and the lion tracks are going in the same place. I don't see any leopard tracks here. Brent, no obvious tracks coming south of Shibam Junction. So Brent reckon he heard the lions in there somewhere. So we're just going to keep going. It sounds like they're still on Djuma, which is very exciting. Brent, just go again with the position of where you think that audio came from. Here. Lions in the mist, we hope. Buffalo going back onto Djuma. Now that strange warmness is coming to the air again. I'm going to stop and have a listen, see if we can pick anything up. Can you hear the crested barbet calling? For a little while and see if we can't hear something. At the moment all I can hear is the alarm clock bird, aka crested barbet. And a ring-necked dove. This is very interesting. Okay, let's go a little bit further along this road. It'd be wonderful if they're in this block somewhere here. It's eerie, misty morning. Such a wonderful atmosphere out here of, well, I guess it's almost mysterious. Hey, Andrew.
I'm loving it. You find some lions, James, please.
So there's still no tracks here. Quite a big block before we get to the next road, so we're going to drive very slowly along here. It's so difficult to see in, and we must keep looking behind us. Tracks on the road yet. and very nice question from Ria. Does the mist muffle the sound? Ria, I think it probably does muffle the sound, you know. I'm not sure to what extent, but it would certainly make it move less, certainly wouldn't go as far. Just get a quick update from Brent. Brent, have you got any updates on your side? Off the vehicle. Right, so now we go full circle round the block. We're going to just go up to the next junction, then we're going to stop and we're going to listen again. Female leopard going up this road. That's very interesting. So, I think this is Sandile and Shadow. Yeah, a female leopard and a young male leopard tracks going up this road. I think they're from yesterday though. The problem is there's so much going on that it's difficult to follow it all. So just in case a few of you didn't know, certainly yesterday apparently Shadow and Sandile did reunite. Whether she has stayed with him or not, I don't know. So Dr. Debbie, she did come and find Sandile. Don't know if she's given him anything to eat, and whether they're still together, I couldn't tell you. Right, we're going to stop and listen here for a while. Sound. Alright, let's go around. Just keep going around in the same direction. See what we can pick up. There are the left tracks. I think they've been driven over. Yeah, no, those are old. That's from yesterday. Shadow and Sandile, and for those of you perhaps new, young male leopard, year old, and his mother, Shadow, and they were seen yesterday around here, heading off that way. And he was on his own for 7 days. I think she came to find him on the 8th day. Whether she has then left him again or not, I don't know. But this was the area in which little Sandile was sort of resident for about 7 days. Killing on his own. Also hashing quite a few kills. Bless you, Andrew. Thank you. Drive a little bit faster, just in case they are sort of going, heading in a southerly direction towards the boundary. Brent is on foot in this block, following up there. And in case you're wondering, It's not a particularly dangerous activity if you know what you're doing. To be off on foot, tracking lions. Lions do see us as the apex predator, and so their natural reaction to us would be to run away if they did see us on foot. So as long as you're careful and you don't sort of surprise them unduly, then it's absolutely fine. And Brent is very good at tracking. Definitely no tracks coming out here. What's that? Not lions. Drive a little bit faster now. See if we can't pick something up. And tracks of the young male leopard, quarantine, three-year-old male leopard, also came into this area. I don't think that they're following each other. I think that was purely a matter of coincidence. Go ahead, Brent. Brent is actually a little bit further to the east of where I thought he was, but following tracks of the male leopard. Alright, so Brent is now back on the vehicle, so let's go across to him and find out what he's been following. And I'll see you just a little bit later, hopefully with some good news.
Welcome back, everyone. And we've got not quite what we're looking for, but still a wonderful sighting to show you nonetheless. We're just going to get into position. Following the tracks of young quarantine, and he's headed into the block behind us. And while we've been doing that, we've come across a nice herd of impala who are about to drink here at the treehouse waterhole. Nervous they are as they approach the water. Not only nervous due to the fact there could be a leopard behind them, instinctively they're nervous that there could be a crocodile in this water. And look at those beautiful reflections in this very still morning. One to start drinking and then the others will. Here we go. One of the adult males is so jumpy. When you're an animal like an impala, it pays to be a bit jumpy. Lots of different things are going to eat you. You can see the mist in the trees. Definitely not cold, but cool morning. I think this mist is going to burn off as the sun gets a bit higher. We're probably in for a scorcher of a Lofeld day. Also doing is giving us an opportunity to listen to see if anything else might have spotted that leopard we're tracking. And if we have a look at this little gentleman right here who's about to drink, there's a female and a young male drinking directly opposite us at the moment. And if we have a look at that young male's horns, they're very straight still. South Africa, there's a wonderful Afrikaans description for these young male impala with their straight horns, and they're called penkop, which basically means pen head. Sorry guys, James is just calling me on the radio. James, yeah. To the south of Shibam, but in that general area, but I'd say almost due south of Shibam, there was lion audio. And there's a little female. That would have been a tiny baby at the beginning of this year, like the penkop or penhead. She's about the same age. Oh, and we've got some Nyala coming as well. A female and two young male Nyala. Oh, there's a female already here. She snuck in amongst the impala. And then we go to the left a bit. There we go. And there you can see that a female Nyala is a bigger antelope than the impala. That's just on the radio with James. James, I'm still at Treehouse. There's a lot of general game drinking at the moment. You can see even the Nyala are also quite jumpy around the water's edge. Off that impala. He's decided he likes that spot to drink, and then Nyala can't. A little family group of Nyala, minus the adult males. peaceful scene. And so peaceful, I keep almost expecting a leopard to appear and break the silence. Now, animals will drink at any time of the day, but you do notice a sort of preference for drinking. And you very seldom find animals like zebra, for example, drinking this early in the morning. They normally drink a bit later once it gets a bit warmer. The nyala are moving off, but the impala are still fanning about. I think we're going to move on now. It has been quite fun sitting here at the waterhole with all the different, two different antelope species that have come down to drink. Unfortunately, we haven't heard any alarm calls or even contact calls from any of the major predators. While I was tracking, we did hear lions, but they did sound like they are to the south of us. So I think we're gonna follow suit with the nyalas and move off and see what else we can find. Nice view of those impala, and we're going to try and get another view now to answer Jennifer from Toronto's question. Jennifer said she heard that when an impala female is pregnant, the metatarsal glands, or that black patch on their sort of ankles, gets larger, and she wants to know if I've ever heard that. Jennifer, I have never heard that. It's not to say it's impossible, but I would say it's very improbable. And it is a gland, so with pregnancy and certain things, it possibly does get larger, but I have never heard that before. We're going to see if we can find a female. I've got some of the last year's baby boys opposite us, but I'm sure a female might pop out into the open. Just seem to be behind the sickle bush at the moment. And yeah, VM's got some. So what Jennifer's talking about, if we have a look there on the back legs, you see that dark patch? I don't imagine it getting bigger when they're pregnant, but as I said, I've never heard that before. Those dark patches on an impala's back legs are glands. And they're quite interesting glands. There's a couple of different theories, some of which I don't think make any sense whatsoever. So when an impala is chased by a predator and they kick out their back legs, that gland will secrete. And there's a couple of theories. One theory is it's to confuse whatever predator that is chasing it. I don't think that is true. And the more plausible explanation about those metatarsal glands is that once they have been chased by a predator, they release that gland secretes and release a pheromone that enables the herd to rejoin and get back to each other. So if you get separated and be able to smell your way home, so to speak, to the rest of the herd, is the more plausible theory out of what the metatarsal gland's purpose is. Now, off. Let's carry on. the last tracks of the unquarantine head south into the block. Unfortunately, our southern boundary is very close there. So I'm going to head off in the opposite direction and see if we can find anything on the northeastern side. So I know James is checking the southern boundary at the moment, so if he finds tracks, he will let me know. The Birminghams have left that buffalo carcass. I haven't been there yet this morning, so I'm not sure how much meat is left. But if they have left a lot of meat, it's possible that they heard the Matimbas, who were down to the south, and they've decided to head down there to sort them out. Love these misty mornings. We spent some time with two antelope now, and now Zah is wondering how many antelope species there are in the Kruger. Now, offhand, I'm not going to be able to tell you, but I can work it out. So let's have a stop and a think quickly. Well, speaking, there's another antelope species, but it's running and it's gone. It was a little steenbok. Is it going to stop? No. So let's think. How many antelope species in the Kruger? Well, we'll start with the two we've seen already. So that's Inyala and Impala. And let's go with the big one next. So we'll go with the big ones next. Wildebeest. Kudu. Wium. You want to throw in any time? Don't be scared. Sable. Roan. Eland. And I think out of the bigger species, waterbuck. Bushbuck. Think. Okay, I think we're done with sort of big ones. Now if we move to the little ones. Blue diker, which we don't get yet. It's a very special species, so we're on 10. Bush diker or common diker, which we see, so 11. Steenbok, 12. Kreisbok, 13. And Klipspringer, 14. Suni, which is a very rare antelope in the Kruger. It only occurs in a very specific spot up right up in the north. So we're on 15. Think, am I forgetting someone obvious? Wium, can you think of anyone?
Thank you.
So we're up to 15. Well, let's keep moving and we'll keep thinking. So we're up to 15. Did I say roan? I think I did. Roan antelope? Study it. So Impala, Inyala. Oh, let's do it by family. That's probably the best way. So we'll start with the truffle-leggeds, or the spiral-horned antelope. So we've got kudu, inyala, bushbuck, eland. And then we'll go dwarf antelopes, steenbok, suni, kreisbok. Klipspring. So we're on 8 there. And I'm trying to think. And then blue diker, common diker, 10. What are we going to say? Impala, 11. Waterbuck, 12. I did forget one. I remembered what it is now. And a cousin of the waterbuck, reedbuck, 13. Now, what are we missing again? And then the hippotragids, or the horse-like antelope, so sable and roan antelope, That puts us at 15. I'm sure we're missing one though. Guys, why don't you see how many antelope you can find for the Kruger and send your answers through to questions at wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. But I'm pretty sure it's between 15 and 20, I think closer to 15. Oh, wildebeest, 16. And out of all those species, we see most of them regularly here on Djuma and Arethusa, except, oh, Suni. Did I say Suni? 17, maybe. So except for blue duiker, Suni, sable, and roan antelope, and elan, we don't really see here either. Towards that buffalo carcass. If the lions have left it, there might be an enterprising hyena or three that decide to take advantage of that. But who knows, there could still be a Birmingham lion close by. Chatting about antelopes, and we've discussed what antelopes we might find here and in the greater Kruger area. Beth is wondering, do we get Thompson's gazelle here? Beth, unfortunately not. Thompson's, or Tommies as they're affectionately known, are very much an East African grassland species, and we do not get them here. The closest Thompson's gazelle to here is probably in Mikumi National Park in Tanzania. Sorry guys, Craig's just calling me on the radio. Go ahead, Craig. Standing by, Craig. Not yet, so tracks of at least three individuals head south on Twin Dams and Weaver's Nest respectively. Tracks across to Twin Dams, also tracks of that of quarantine also head south into the block off Treehouse Road. I'm heading back towards the towards the buffalo carcass to see if maybe some of the other animals are still there. At least one set of lion tracks, possibly more. James is in that area. I'm not going to go the way you would expect me to, down across past the dam to where those lions are. I'm going to go check around from the little shortcut that goes past the Gallagher waterhole. Maybe the lions discovered that nice clean water. Maybe some of them went that way. So let's go have a look. And also it'd give me a chance, because it's quite very close to the hyena dam, to see if any tracks are headed that way. Doesn't seem to be lifting at all so far this morning. If we look across quarantine, it's still very, very misty. very much to Barry, Joe and Anne, who did some research, and they say there are 21 antelope species in Kruger. Now, I'm going to have to think quite long and hard about what they possibly could be. We've got to, I think, 17, so we're missing five. VM and I are going to think very carefully about what the missing five could be. Ah, sesame. I think sesame naturally occurred in the north of Kruger. So we're on 18 now. So we're still missing a few. Red duiker might be one of them, but I think it's, for me, I feel like it's right on the edge of their range. Or we'll put red duiker in brackets at the moment. Yet to be confirmed, I'll have to check on my book on that one. And since we've been discussing antelopes in such depth, Chris from Oregon is wondering what makes an antelope? Ah, that is a very good question. Lion tracks, well spotted, Wium. So I think we're still going to go through and check the carcass and then we'll come back to these tracks. So, speaking of antelope, there's an antelope. One that doesn't normally sit too still for us. Male common duiker, or Grimm's bush duiker is an old name for them. And you can see those, oh, there you go. So don't sit still too often. And below its eyes, you can see those preorbital glands. It's used for scent marking. Itchy ear. Off he goes. A rate of knots. So all antelope, interestingly, are part of the bovid family, or bovididae family, and they are all ruminants, so they all have four stomachs and they chew the cud. They'll bring food up from their stomachs and re-eat it. Now antelope are not, I'm sorry, antelope are not deers, and deer are not antelope. Deer belongs to a different family called Cervididae. And the main difference between an antelope and a deer is to do with the horn. Antelope all have, or sometimes male and female, but other times just the males, have horns. The horns are permanent. They are bone encased in keratin, and they do not fall off, whereas deer's antlers are pure keratin, and they fall off after the rutting season, so they are not a permanent fixture. And that is probably one of the major differences between deer and antelope. And I've got an interesting question for you guys. So, how many deer species occur in Africa, and in what country do deer naturally occur in Africa? And you can send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Approaching the Gallagher waterhole now. there's a comment from Gil about, do Liechtenstein's hardebeest occur in Kruger? They do not. They are a Miombo or Brachystegia woodland specialist, so we don't get them naturally occurring in South Africa at all. The only naturally occurring hardebeest species in South Africa is the red hardebeest. Whoops, over a bump there. And the red hardebeest occurs in the far more arid west of South Africa. No lions here. Tracks here. Looks like more than one. Unfortunately, the ground here is quite difficult to show you the track, especially in this very dull light. But at least two here. Maybe they snuck off for a drink this morning and have snuck back towards the carcass via a different route. The leaky Land Cruiser, as Wium calls it, has been on this route. So it's one of the other game drive vehicles has a very distinct track that Wium and I have noticed. It leaves a trail of what we think is possibly brake fluid or clutch fluid, and very regular little drops. And we can see where, we're not sure who it is yet, but we can see where they've been by their vehicle leaking on the road. As soon as we do find out who it is, we will tell them so they can fix it. Lines. We've got a very nice comment from Amy, who wants to know what happened to the pride of 13 lions from April. That's what got it fixed on Safari Live. Hello, mister. I can see there's some vultures, Amy. I will tell you about those lions shortly. But the interesting fact is there are vultures. There's a white-backed vulture ahead of me there. Quite a lot of vultures off to the left as well, and a hooded vulture, a second species in the tree, but they are on, they're in the tree, and quite often that is a telltale sign that there's possibly a predator on the ground. The fact that they haven't descended to take advantage of the fact that the lion's left, so there could possibly be a lion there. So the fact that the vultures are in the trees is a good sign. We might be completely wrong, but let's go have a look. Sorry about that, Amy. I just happened to spot a carrion eater, or a couple of carrion eaters, and being in the trees. Makes me think that there possibly might be a lion around. Amy, that big pride of lions that we saw in April, and in the mist, if I remember correctly, the one took a very big shining to Andrew, and it looked like it was thinking about making Andrew dinner or breakfast that morning. They're called the Tsalala Breakaway Pride or the Mungen Pride, and they generally, their territory is further to the west and south of us. They do occasionally come into Arethusa, but very occasionally, so we don't see them that often. That would, what made that sighting so special. And for me, what made that sighting so special is that is a pride or a breakaway pride from a pride I used to watch regularly when I worked further south. Oh, that's what he thinks of us, so we're going to move on. So, from a pride we used to spend a lot of time with, like James as well, called the Tsalala Pride, that lives around the Sand River. And at the time we were there, it was the smallest pride and sort of got chased around by a lot of the other lions, and it's now become such a big pride that they had to split, which is incredible. Vultures on the ground. Those vultures up in the trees obviously have got full gullets, and the hyenas here. Awesome. The hyenas still not approaching right at the carcass because it's probably worried that the lions just got there might still be around. But this is exactly what I was hoping for. An adventurous hyena. Doesn't want to come up to the carcass just in case there's a male lion around. Now, Pam, just come down. That is not something you see every day. Stop and to the left. So you can see the buffalo horns there. I just saw an oxpecker land on a dead buffalo. I'm going to try and move forward a little bit. And strangely enough, quite often the ticks will actually evacuate. Where's it gone? There we go. Now that is not something I think I've ever seen before. So once the animal's dead, the ticks will generally start moving away. But as we've seen, often oxpeckers will open the flesh or open wounds in buffalo and eat the blood. So maybe they're taking advantage of that here. But this is definitely a very interesting little bit of behavior that I definitely haven't seen before. Amazing. Where's the hyena gone? That's still there. Position ourselves. So obviously the hyena is very nervous approaching this carcass because how's that feel? Oh, and it's walking away from a pile of meat. There's the hyena disappearing there. And the one thing that scares the living daylights out of hyenas is male lions. I think they heard other lions last night, and that's why they departed. See, the eyes have been eaten out, and that would have been, there we go, by the vultures. So the hyena is still obviously very worried that the male lions might be around. I can just see it disappearing into the distance. Should probably let the hyena know that the tracks went south. He's okay, they're quite far away. And there's a different vulture species now that Wium has found. And that is a hooded vulture, the smallest of the vulture species we get here. I was hoping for a little bit more action around here, but unfortunately not. I definitely think as it warms up and more vultures come, we might get a mass of vultures on this carcass a little bit later. But in the meantime, we're going to head off and try to see exactly where those lion tracks that we saw around the Galago waterhole went. So we had at least tracks of two or three going south around Weaver's Nest, Twin Dams. And these are going more west, so we're going to loop around and see if we can see where they went that way. As we depart from that buffalo carcass, Pam in Florida is wondering whether the Birmingham boys left that carcass because the meat was diseased. I don't think so, Pam. I think they've heard other lions, and they are busy in what I'm calling a lion war at the moment, trying to take over the Matimba's territories. And I think the Matimba's days are numbered, to be honest, as the five marauding Birminghams come through. I think they've heard the Matimbas to the south and they've gone down there to go sort them out. But lions will happily eat diseased, rotten, smelly, maggot-filled meat without even worrying. Far stronger constitution than us. I just got an update on the other guys, what was happening there. Craig, Craig. Yeah, I've just gone past the buffalo. There's no animals on it. There are tracks heading west from the Galago waterhole. Craig, did you copy that update? Just bypassed the buffalo carcass, there's nothing there, just vultures. There are tracks of Gala heading west across Galago shortcut. I'm going to check around towards Aubrey's and Vertel Axis. I just have to have a morning meeting with tax. Morning. How are you, Mfo?
Good, thanks.
Job. Hello, Tumfich. One of Nisi, but it's too sour to go close.
You have to miss it this morning?
No. Are you going to go there?
Yeah.
There's, in terms of those lines, some of the, or three went, at least three went down Twin Dams, Weaver's Nest, and the others are going west towards. So I'm gonna go around and check from Vertel Axis. Okay. Thanks, Dex. Enjoy, guys. Sorry about that, folks. Just having my morning meeting with Taxon, figuring out where the lions might have gone. So Tax is gonna check from this side, and we're gonna loop around and check from the other side. We're gonna cover both areas to give us the best possible chance of finding out where the Birminghams went. And hopefully, even better, we can find out why they left. to Joanne, Bob, Matt, and Sharon, who are the correct, who gave the correct answers to the deer quiz. So the only indigenous deer species in Africa is the Barbary red deer, or very closely related to the red deer of Europe, and it occurs in Algeria, Tunisia, and Morocco. And at the moment, the only wild population I know of is in the Atlas Mountains in Morocco. And also, a lot of you guys said fallow deer, which I'll introduce, so it is correct. They are fallow deer in South Africa even, but there is a program in certain areas to actually eradicate them because they are not an indigenous species. But well done for that, guys. I almost have a little sneaky suspicion that those, or not, that those Barbary red deer, so there used to be a land bridge between Africa and the Middle East, and it was at a time that was a lot wetter than we are now, and for example the deserts and Israel and the whole Middle East were actually grassland savannas, so and that is the time when those animals would have moved, and deer would have just sort of touched into Africa before the sea rose and just isolated this really distinct population of deer. And at that time, it was also probably one of the times during one of the human migrations. So all people come from Africa. We're all African at somewhere in our history. It's probably quite a long way in our history. And there are two major human migrations out of Africa. One was about 80,000 years ago, and the other was about 20,000 years ago. And if I remember correctly, those deer crossed at that first sort of land bridge, and the same time as humans left Africa, the deer moved in about 80,000 years ago. But we're going to continue on in search of kitty cats. Cross across to Commander Bond, who's hopefully having a little bit more luck with the tracks than we are. I suspect not, though. So we are trying our best, but let's go see what James has been up to for the last while, and we're going to go loop ahead and try and see if we can find those lines.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Wendy after your extended sojourn with Brent Leo Smith. I have to confess that these lions have totally flummoxed me. They were heading south down a particular road, then they went off into a block. They have not emerged from that block. I have looked in that block. I have looked around that block. I have looked through that block. I have not found any lions. And I haven't found a whole lot else either. We did have one fairly spectacular fish eagle sighting, but unfortunately you were with the vultures, which meant that it was a toss-up as to whether you should be looking at our fish eagle or at the vultures with BLS. That's Brent Leo Smith, Andrew, in case you were wondering. The morning continues to be eerily misty and sort of coastally warm, and there's no sun, as you can see. So I think I'm probably going to give up on the lions for now and head off in another direction and see what else we might be able to see. It's starting to get a little bit lighter. I am just going to check up here briefly. I don't know why. Something has said to me, look up here in this old quarry. Yes, whatever it was that said to me, look in this old quarry, was clearly lying to me. Well, the old quarry is not filled with lions. See any lions in here, Andrew? No, I don't see any lions at all. Right, we shall turn around. We may turn the vehicle over by mistake, that would be unpleasant. I think the animals tend to do quite a lot of hiding on a day like today. They like to go into the thicker bush where they can sort of remain hidden. We've seen a few. Oh, look at that. That is actually quite interesting. And do you see that?
Yes.
I'm just going to get my book out. That's an ant nest, everyone. And they're not very common out here. I don't see them very often at all. I'm going to quickly retrieve my insect field guide and see if I can't find out what kind of an ant it is. Other than the obviously, I mean, I could make it up and tell you it was a tree-dwelling mud ant or something like that, and you'd probably have to believe me. Would you believe me, Andrew?
I think so.
Yeah, that's good. Well, that's what we shall call it then. Hymenoptera, sawflies, wasps, bees, and ants. We've only got to narrow it down now from about 100,000 species, so that's good. But I think I've seen this one in my book before. Let me have a quick look-see. So those ants will make it that little nest there. It obviously provides them with some safety, and the predators that would take ants would mainly be birds, of course, and you can see how a bird would struggle to be able to get into that while perching somewhere on a tree or somewhere nearby that. Come on, here we go. No, it's not in the book. It is not in the book. Alas. No. Anyway, I have seen them on the odd occasion before, and they will spend time basically lurking about the tree for the most part, because of the safety that it offers from birds and also probably from other ants. You know, the greatest raiders of termite mounds and ant colonies are other ants of different species, and they like to take the larvae and they take the eggs. And I once witnessed a tremendous battle between a red army and a black army, and the red ants were raiding the black ants' home, and they were carting off while the soldiers were engaged in a tremendous battle. The red workers were going down into the black ant nest, pulling out the youngsters and the eggs, putting them on their backs and walking off in a sort of protected line with a phalanx of soldiers on each side, taking off the baby ants to their own nest to unfortunately consume them or make them into slaves. I don't think they really made them into slaves. I think they ate them. Ant life is fascinating. Not quite as fascinating as lion life, but it is still very fascinating. So I think on a warm morning like this, the lions probably have gone down to rest. It's warm, so we're going to cut our losses, I think, and head out of this area and see what else we can find. So I was completely wrong about the mist. Sorry, there's a nest here. Can you see it there, Andrew? Just a timely reminder there from ex-Ranga that you chaps have the power of Google, so I must be very careful about making up names for things. And this I'm not going to make up. That is the nest of the blue waxbill. And the blue waxbill is a beautiful, tiny little sort of finch-like blue bird. And that's his nest there. They like to make them in thorn trees, obviously to try and escape the attentions of mainly snakes, I think, but snakes are very adept in these sorts of trees. And they also sometimes build their nests, of course, next to paper wasps, or sort of common garden variety hornets, if you like, and that definitely deters predators. So that is the blue waxbill nest. I'm not going to go and disturb it, just because we are now getting towards what will be the breeding season for the birds, and so There may be something in it, I'm not sure, and we don't want to disturb it. As soon as you touch a nest like that, they tend to be abandoned quite quickly. Maybe a little look at that fork-tailed drongo, Andrew. Can you get in there?
Yeah.
Now, the fork-tailed drongo I have become more and more fond of as I've worked here at Djuma. I've obviously seen hundreds and hundreds of them during my time. But because we spend such extended periods out here, and often, you know, when we're not live, we're still studying what's going on out here, and so we get time to just watch. These drongos are remarkable birds. They do an incredible array of fairly poor imitations of other birds, and I still have yet to find a definitive reason for why birds do imitate other birds, other than for breeding, because it certainly can't be to con the actual species, because drongo you can hear all the time, whether it's being a drongo or whether it's actually trying to make another bird's call. So on we go. An impala just up ahead. An impala, a little steenbok running high speed. Allow us to get anything like this sort of view. They often just disappear. Although Brent had a wonderful sighting of one the other day with the leopard just 3 meters behind it. Wonder if you can hear that. There's a pearl-spotted owl calling. Listen. Starting to emerge. There are buds on the trees. A couple of the migrant birds have come back. So just going back to the ant's nest there from Lisa Osborne, would they be arboreal ants? Well, they're certainly some form of arboreal ant, absolutely. Living in a tree, arboreal. But I'm sure there are lots of different species of arboreal ants. Lisa, I would say probably at least 100. So which one it was, I don't know. You know, the diversity of invertebrate life in the world is absolutely astonishing. And they reckon that we're probably losing species of invertebrate faster than we're actually describing them. So they're coming. It's just an astonishing number that we have yet to fathom. Seen, Andrew?
No. I thought it was something like...
What a deep pity. A deep and abiding pity, Andrew. Really sure what to say here. Curious one, John and Charlie Apparently you heard the sounds of revelry into the night last night on the Djuma Dam cam. I'm slightly amazed that you managed to hear any of that. I didn't think that we were that loud, but we did have a very, well, I wouldn't say a rip snorter, but we certainly had a very pleasant evening last night with some songs around the campfire. There was a little bit of Hendrix, I suppose, but I cannot claim to be anything like the guitarist that Jimmy was, despite our sharing a similar name, both forename and surname, but I bet his middle names were nothing like mine. He was, of course, also left-handed, and went to meet the guitar gods 10 years prior to my current age. Here we are back at Treehouse Dam, which I believe you have been to already with BLS. As you can see, all the water is now turning into rather muddy cesspits full of algae, which is very nice if you're a goose. Not so nice if you happen to be something that likes to drink fresh water, like elephants. And if you're a leopard or a lion, it doesn't seem to really matter what kind of water there is. You just drink it anyway. Let's do one more loop through this road, and then we're going to head back east, possibly towards the cheetah cut line, and see what's coming across there. Lots of buffalo activity around here. You can see plenty of dung around the place, and I'm sure they've been, it looked to me like they'd been harassed by the lions last night. You know, indications of running buffalo tracks and that sort of thing. You can also start to see now the kind of, I don't like to use the word damage, but I suppose the effect that the elephants have on an area like this, where they just push down so many trees, they really do change the structure of the vegetation profoundly. And without them, the vegetation would be very, very different indeed. While we're driving along, looking at not very much, wondering where the lions have gone, a lovely question from John in California. John, your question is about whether the Matimbas are delaying the inevitable by not having a face-off with the Birmingham boys, or if, and whether the Birmingham boys are perhaps actively seeking them out. John, you know, I don't think they are being actively sought out, no, I don't think that happens. I think that the B-boys will only seek them out if there is an attempt by the Matimbas to assert their authority. So were the Matimbas to start calling, then the Birmingham boys would go and look for them. But what often happens, John, is that the lions, who know that their days are numbered, just disappear. If they are, here, look here the lions are going down this road. Tracks. This is interesting. Anyway, we'll quietly drive along here and with any luck bump into two male lions or so. And John, so unless they are, you know, believe they have a fighting chance, and I mean that's an essential belief, I don't think they would necessarily stop to have have a face-off. I think they'll just quietly disappear. Maybe they'll be able to take another territory. That's not uncommon. So they might go into another area and take another territory. But I'm really not sure at this stage what's going to happen with them. It's all very interesting. Lions are around here somewhere. Andrew, you are looking around, are you?
Yes, sir.
You're not sleeping behind those sunglasses of yours. Andrew, why do you have sunglasses on, given that there is no sun?
Still a little glare.
Glare.
Ah,
yes. There are lions going down this road. It would be fascinating to find them. Still on the road. The lions. Must have gone through there. So there's only one male. Anyway, we're just going to keep driving along here. They're clearly moving around a lot. And John in California, this is another indication of their desire to now try and sort of take the territory, because what they do is that they'll move around a lot, they'll split up while they're trying to take over the territory. And I did hear, I've just got an update on the radio now, that the Matimba males are in Malamala. Now that's well south, that's two farms south of us here. So they are absolutely not trying to make a final stand, John. And I just want to stop and have a listen. It's always a good idea. Just stop, listen, and see what's going on. So this tree, everybody, is called the green thorn, or Balanites magami, or a torchwood. And it produces that amazing seed that produces an oil that you can burn. I have numerous occasions tried to burn it in public in order to make a demonstration, and I have done nothing but burn my fingers. The point of the stop is to show you how the tree is not dead and how incredible the adaptations are to coping with elephants out here. So an elephant has clearly taken this tree down and it's still growing. And in fact, it's starting to sprout. They are evergreens, but it is starting to sprout some new leaves off of the damage that the elephants have done. And I do find that absolutely astonishing. And I think that you'll find that there are probably very few trees outside of areas where elephants occur that would be able to recover in the same way. Right, on we go, Andrew. So when we came down this road initially, there were lion tracks on it, and they're still there, but they weren't the same ones that we had coming down here. We're on Twin Dams Road again. So I'm deeply confused as to exactly where they are or what they're doing. So I don't think we're going to hang about too much longer here. We'll head east. See what's happening in the east. temperature has hardly changed. Started out this morning. 17 degrees. Losing communications here. Keep an eye out, Andrew. Can you get him?
Yes.
Look at that. I love watching these little birds. You can sit and watch them for ages. Andrew, is that your favorite?
Yeah.
They are. That is the yellow-billed hornbill, so named for his what, Andrew?
Yellow bill.
Correct. Well done. Sometimes if you are with a guide who's a little bit sort of tired of being a guide, he will tell you that that is the flying banana, and its yellow-billed cousin, red-billed cousin, is a flying chili. Now, much in the way that should a guide ever tell you the story of the McDonald's of the bush, should a guide ever tell you that that is the flying banana, you should complain immediately and attempt to find another guide. Andrew, when you were a guide, did you ever use the term flying banana?
Flying bananas and chilies all around.
That's why Andrew is now a cameraman. The biology of the hornbill is amazing, and I mean, I've spoken at length various times about their breeding and their amazing breeding that they have, but that bill also allows them to eat all sorts of different things. Those yellow hornbills will kill things as big as chameleons and eat them. I've seen about the members of the Sui Day that we get out here, Andrew. The Sui Day are the pigs. And the warthogs, Bugsy, we don't see a huge number of them here. We do see them, but not very often. And to say that there aren't a lot around, but they are, quite interestingly, the most vulnerable. There's a giraffe. They are the most vulnerable to drought. So we have to, they going into the next few weeks and months are going to be the most at risk if we don't get rain. And that's because they are water dependent. They're obviously not designed to migrate great distances with their short squat frames. Those are not lions in front of us. In fact, those are human beings having coffee. I don't think we'll stop and view them for too long.
All right.
So that is a fellow from south of us, Chitwa, I believe. And he's just saying that the tracks of some of the Birmingham males are on his reserve. So we've now left that area. Now you are going to lose signal briefly. Please do not panic. Please remain calm, and we're going to just go through this dip, and then we'll see you again. Hold on, Andrew. Right, I think we're back and stable, but we're going to hand you over to Brent Leo Smith, who is with the hyena den, and I think there's some activity there, so I'll see you just now.
Welcome back, everyone. After seeing that nervous hyena around the buffalo carcass and the den site being so close to Wium and I decided we should come have a look. Now, I wouldn't describe the den as active at the moment, as Wium's exact words, but there are hyenas, very lazy hyenas, having a nice Sunday morning snooze. Looks like we can only see two of the sub-adults at the moment. Can't see any other adults around the den, and I'm sure the little guy's inside somewhere. Oh, it's that tired hyena. Seems like everyone's lazy today. And we can see how the grass is disappearing as the hyenas utilize this den more. Just their movements up and down the mound is creating a nice sandy termite mound. Looks like they've got quite nice fat bellies, so they've definitely eaten something recently. And you can almost describe the looks of these two little hyenas as being in almost a food coma. Fat belly, Sunday morning, fast asleep. I think Wium and I are quite jealous of those hyenas at the moment. They look so comfy. So obviously the call hasn't gone out that buffalo carcass that the Birminghams have abandoned for now is safe. Otherwise, I'm sure these two would be in the thick of it. And if they were full, they'd be sleeping very close to that food source. Obviously had a busy Saturday night, the teenagers out partying all night. But nice to stop in here, but I don't think they're going to do much more. And we did find those lion tracks that looked like they were heading to the west. We thought we'd just stop into that hyena den quickly, see what was happening. But as you can see, not much movement here. Leave the little guys fast asleep. I'm quite sure that I this a quick trim. There we go. So the cameramen don't have to keep ducking. That Commander Bond has managed to get another flat tire. I don't understand how these guys keep getting these flat tires, Ben. I've never get flat tires. I think I have had one flat tire in my whole time here, and that was from someone else. I collected a car in the morning that already had a flat tire. Really have to learn to watch where they're driving. I mean, honestly. So we're going to go back onto those lion tracks that are separate from the ones James and I were started following this morning. So they split. It seems some went that way, some went that way. So some went south, some went west. Maybe they're planning on using the old Zulu war maneuver called the horns of the buffalo. There you attack your enemies and then sweep round in the shape of a buffalo horn and come at them from all angles. Timbers, beware. From the hyena den, Lisa is wondering, is there only one clan in Djuma and Arethusa? Well, there's definitely one clan here that in this section of Djuma, and they control the whole of Djuma and a little bit into Arethusa. There's another clan to the west of Arethusa, and that's the next closest clan. So Arethusa is on the boundary between these two clans, but on Djuma we only have one clan. Thank you. update the game drive. The station's leaving. Nisikai still active. Two monkey puns visible. Tracks of at least one of the Birmingham boys are heading south on Zoe's. We're following up. On these male lion tracks, I'm gonna check. They go over there. Them says they're going to Zoe's. There they go. So there they go, straight down the road. And those of you who watch regularly will often feel the same frustration that we do is when we track an animal up to a boundary and then it crosses. And Blair from British Columbia is wondering, why can we not cross these boundaries? And if we are on foot, can we cross just on the vehicle? So Blair, where we are in the Sabi Sands is privately owned land, and we do not have traversing agreements yet with certain of the landowners. Therefore, that's the reason we don't cross. So it is the same as going into someone's house without permission, so to speak. So that is why we do respect the boundaries, and we traverse on Djuma and Arethusa. Oh no, they're still there. I thought the lions have done a sneaky puff addering disappearing act, but they haven't. They're still going down the road. So Blair, that's the reason. It is private land, and obviously, if you don't have permission to go onto someone's private land, you don't go. Now, where did these lions go? They have left the road. Question is, where did they leave the road? And which way did they leave the road? Little walk around here, see which directions the lions went. And I say directions because they might have split and gone in different directions, but I do think they probably have stuck together. Double check, it looks like they've gone off that way. Just make sure others haven't gone somewhere else. Okay, so well, at least we've got a direction to go check now. So we're going to continue down Zoe's road and then loop around. The general direction is towards an area called the Impala Plains. So hopefully they are lying out in the open on the nice open grassland at the Impala Plains. Thank you.
update the game drive channel quickly. Gonzo of these one in Angara cut west from Zay's Road. General direction is towards Marla Plains. I'm still following. James is getting his morning exercise, having to change the tire, and I'm sure that the jack that is being used is about the same size as James, so quite a big job for him to do. Of early birthday wishes coming in. Thanks very, very much, guys. I do appreciate it. And John is wondering, am I going to go do some fly fishing somewhere for my birthday? Well, John, I actually am. Strangely enough, I'm going to spend 2 days of fishing up in the mountains, and I'm going to be fishing for trout, which is something I haven't fished for in a very long time, and hopefully I can catch a few. To go get all my fishing kit out of storage, dust off the old fly tying kit. It's an interesting time of the year for trout fishing in South Africa as the end of winter comes and the summer begins, and the trout tend to take some very strange flies at this time of the year. So definitely gonna have to take my fly tying kit with me, find out what insects and aquatic insects are in the water, and see if I can make something to match. Otherwise, I'm probably gonna have a very hungry couple of days. And breaking through a bit of the cloud there. A lot of our regular viewers will know, African wild dog is my favorite animal. And Scott and Dara from Ohio are wondering if I've heard of a female wild dog in northern Botswana whose pack was killed and she sort of couldn't get over her sort of pack instinct, so to speak, and started spending time with hyena and jackal. And they'd also like to know how common this is. Well, guys, it's really uncommon. I mean, I think that is the only ever recorded case of this happening. And that was in an area on Chief's Island in Maremi Game Reserve in Botswana. And I had heard about it, and I have actually been to that area before, but I haven't seen that particular wild dog. But it is very, very rare and very unusual behavior. So it is probably the first, if not the only time, or definitely the only time it's ever been recorded by people. Not to say it hasn't happened beforehand, when we weren't following them around every day, we were more worried about catching our own dinner on the African savannah. but very, very rare and very, very fascinating. And I would say that's definitely not the norm, and probably not something that we will see again within our lifetimes. So I'm hoping those tracks pop out in this general area. This is where they were heading as we move down towards the open grassland of Impala Plains. Fighting the good fight, trying to break through this mist bank. No lions on the open plains. We will keep checking. I still don't see. Still in this block. So what's going to happen if I don't find any tracks coming out here? Wium and I are going to shoot back to that last footprint we had in the road, and we'll probably take a walk. I'll take a walk from there to see if I can pull a lion out of the bush by its tail. Promising, no tracks coming out yet. I'm checking very carefully at the moment. While we are in search of Africa's largest member of the carnivore family, we're going to cross back to James, who's with the smallest member of Africa's carnivore family.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Wendy, who's just had a shoe change. Unfortunately, one of her shoes deflated while we were sitting doing absolutely nothing. So I'm not sure why that happened, but it has been, but it is fixed, thanks to the imaginations of Andrew and I. Now, we are looking at a dwarf mongoose. We were looking at a dwarf mongoose. Now we appear to be looking, oh, there's one. You can see some movement there in the middle. Oh, look at that. Veritable hive of activity for this morning. Lots of them there on their little termite mound. They're not venturing very far. Staying well within little refuges within their territory. Now, we had some questions about spring and the arrival thereof, and tomorrow, I believe, is the 1st of September. Is that correct, Andrew?
That's correct.
The 1st of September, of course, is the official start of spring, and so I shall declare winter thoroughly over. There's some elephants, Andrew. Right through there.
Really?
Don't worry, I will show them to you. I will show them to you. So tomorrow is spring, but there are elephants, and we're going to go and see them. They're wandering through the bush there at quite a high speed. I wonder why. How close are we to that other road there? Quite far. I'm just going to go in here quickly. If they're running, I'm afraid, everybody, we're not going to be able to have a very good view of them. The bush is pretty thick through here. They are so amazingly silent when they want to be. It's incredible. I just saw shadows moving through the bush here. Did you see them, Andrew?
No, I didn't see them.
I promise I'm not going mad. Well, I might be, but that's not... I didn't see them. It was actually amazing. They were just sort of melting down through here. We can see them after a day of fairly quiet action up here. There they go. Can you see them?
Yeah.
Isn't that incredible? You can't even hear them. A little herd of elephants. We'll try and get a little bit closer. They are in some very thick bush, I'm afraid. Cow, and she's just hiding from us and remaining almost invisible in this fairly thick brush. This doesn't look good for following animals, I must say. There is a road not too far from here, so maybe they'll go out onto that. Watch your teeth, everybody. Now, chaps, I'm afraid these elephants are not happy. Every time we get vaguely close to them, they disappear off again. Now, I'm afraid I'm not going to follow them through here. Very thick, and they don't seem to be very relaxed. So I think all we're going to do is harass them. So I'm afraid, despite the lack of large game today, I'm going to leave those elephants. Now, Andrew did find a flower, which I have now lost. We had a question about the beginning of spring. Heidi in Zurich, where I'm afraid your autumn begins officially tomorrow. Ha ha ha. I've now lost the flower that Andrew especially got for us. Oh well, sorry about that, Andrew, but we did find a flower, and unfortunately while we were changing Wendy's tire, we managed to dislodge it from the ground, so we thought we'd retrieve it and show it to you. Sorry about that, Heidi, but there are signs of spring. We have seen the odd tree with a few leaves on it, so I'll try and find a few more as we go off towards Buffelshoek Dam. We're quite close to that now, so I'm just going to go and see what we can see at Buffelshoek Waterhole. One of the last remaining decent sort of water holes there is around here. The rest have dried up into those muddy pools. And if you, some of you were unfortunate enough to see me wading about in yesterday. Don't worry, Andrew, we shall be out of here soon. Fear not. Watch the knob thorn. Watch the thorns, everyone. nice question from Siberia Zumi. And I think, Siberia, was it not you that sent me the information on the umbilical hernia? If it was, thank you very much. But basically, we saw a distressed cow earlier in the week, everybody. And what distressed means that she just looked very uncomfortable. She looked to be a bit nervous of the vehicle. She was moving quite slowly. And we saw a swelling under her belly that I couldn't identify. And one of our very kind, I think it was Siberia, one of our very kind viewers, in fact two of you, sent through some information on something called a umbilical hernia, which is quite common in elephants apparently. And it's a hernia that occurs just in the umbilical region. So it normally resolves on its own, but it can eventually cause death if left untreated. Although they did attempt some kind of a treatment on an elephant in Zimbabwe, but the elephant did die 10 days later. I really think that we lack the experience to be able to interfere in these things successfully most of the time. So, yeah, I don't think we'd do anything about it. But I haven't seen her again, Siberia. I'm not sure where she's gone. But I did see a herd of elephants 2 days ago. And there was a young bull there with a similar thing. It wasn't as big as that cow's, but he definitely had a little bit of one of those sort of umbilical hernias. I thought that the mist this morning was going to be some kind of a sort of, like those typical misty mornings we get where the mist lifts, but it really isn't. This is a cloudy, leaden day. Oh, and I have got the dates wrong. Sorry, tomorrow is not the 1st of September. That's on Tuesday. Thank you, Georgianne, for that. And Heidi, you say that autumn is very wonderful in Zurich. Well, that's good. I always get slightly depressed at the end of the summer season. But I suppose autumn's also very beautiful here. Not so much for the colors, because the colors don't tend to change hugely. But because it's quite just a bit cooler. The summer here is obviously fairly beastly hot. I think it was 36 degrees at the height of the day yesterday. So that's, I mean, we're not officially out of winter yet, and we were sitting at 36 degrees. Can you imagine what the summer's going to be like? There is a lovely smell though around the place. It's very fresh and most fragrant, hey Andrew? And every so often you drive through an area that does smell quite sweet. And I think that's because some of the acacias are starting to come into flower, some of the knob thorns. I haven't seen one yet though. Perhaps they only flush on the 1st of September. Again, you can see this bush is quite, I mean, I suppose on your screens it must look fairly harsh because it's grey, there's a grey sky, the grass is very dry now, and so it's going from that kind of golden brown to a more golden grey. But after a while, after some time in an area like this, what I found is that I just started to appreciate the greyness for some reason, and it's just very inspiring, because especially that I know come November it's going to be bright green and unrecognizable from what it is now. Magpie shrike. You got him, Andrew?
Yeah, he's just behind this tree now.
Okay. There's a magpie shrike. Lovely lilting call. They live in a little flock. There's another one to the left of that one. And you can hear, they're called magpie because of the color, of course, not because they have the habits, the thieving habits of the European magpie. And a robin calling off in the drainage line.
opposite. There's another magpie shrike on the ground. Plenty of elephant tracks here heading towards Buffelshoek Dam, at which we are about to arrive. And the ubiquitous tracks of hyena, which tease me, looking almost like leopard tracks until you stop and look. I believe the den was active today, so that's quite fun. And I'm glad those two other youngsters seem to be back there. I was worried that they were only going to move with the pack, with the clan now, and that they wouldn't come back to the den. I'm glad to hear they were there today. Right, let us see on this leaden day what has come down to drink, if anything at all. Looking hopeful at this stage. Andrew, do you see a vast bevy of animals here?
I see a hippo.
Oh goodness. That is marvellous news. Well spotted. Look at that. Bob, the Bachelor of Bob, seems to be back and actually doing something. So every so often, everybody, for the last 3 months or so while I've been here, there's been a single hippo in this dam. He lurked about here for about I'd say 3 or 4 weeks continuously. Then there were two at one stage, and we thought maybe a new pod would be forming. But then he headed off, or she headed off first, and so did he. And I don't think it's particularly deep in the middle there for a hippopotamus. But this is the kind of refuge that a young bull will take. If he's been kicked out of the pod, and it's a pretty good spot for him to be, actually. Until he's big enough and strong enough and regained his strength to go and take a pod of his own or a territory of his own in a more salubrious neighborhood, say, in the Sand River. I'm just looking at his skin. He does look like he's got quite a lot of scarring on the back. And I'm sure that's from a fight with a territorial bull. And in case you're wondering, he's not swimming, he is walking on the base. Hippos are not great swimmers because they sink. And that doesn't mean they can't float. At least it doesn't mean they can't be in deep water. Sorry, I went silent there because they loud ringing noise blasted through Andrew and my ears, but it seems to have gone away. So let's see what else we can hear. I can hear some hornbills. Thank you.
behind the headland there. If you zoom in exactly where you are now, you'll get him. A little bit to the right. He's somewhere in there. I think he's gone now. So we've got the three-banded plover. You got him?
Yeah.
Brilliant. That's a three-banded plover. And there was a blacksmith lapwing running around as well. A couple of dwarf mongoose I can see nipping across the dam wall. Some doves. I think those hornbills are having a little territorial dispute. There are also a number of other rather more irritating organisms, and those are flies that are now starting to set upon us with a great enthusiasm.
Plenty
of flies, yes.
All the flies.
And also, in the water, there are the serrated hinged terrapins, which are freshwater turtles. And you can actually see, and can you see them all? You can see little heads. Their heads are sticking up above the surface of the water. And you can just see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are lots of them. Those little sort of marks that you can see on the water surface there are terrapin heads. And they'll be scavenging for all sorts of things. They're largely carnivorous, but they'll eat anything that is rotting. They'll eat ticks off buffaloes. There's a great beeping in our ears again. Not sure if that means that the final control has exploded, but I think we'll pretend like everything's okay and carry on from Buffelshoek Dam. It's very peaceful, and although the morning hasn't been full of action, it's definitely been very pleasant. Andrew, are you still getting that rather disturbing beeping noise?
Yes.
I'm not sure what that is.
Did you press the panic button?
I didn't push any button there. Okay. We seem to be back now. Huh? So for a long time, everybody, when I first started as a ranger, we didn't have what we call these closed communications with the earpiece. And what that meant was that the radio became one of the major things for you to manage on game drive with your guests. Because A, obviously they could hear what you could hear, and so if a leopard was found 100 miles away, you'd have to give an explanation for why you couldn't go and see that leopard. And they were constantly listening to the radio, and it also became very intrusive to the wilderness experience if you didn't turn the car off and then turn the radio off. And now, these days, of course, we operate with the earpieces, and it's a whole different suite of skills to deal with, because you've got to be able to somehow see me. You would have seen me talking quietly, and then suddenly I'd go bleary-eyed like a deer that had been caught in the headlamps. And what that meant was that I was instruction from Tara or Nikki. And then I would suddenly come out of this trance and begin speaking again. And that's basically learning to deal with the speaking and listening at the same time. It's not an easy skill. As I'm speaking to you now, I'm getting an update from Texon and Aubrey about various bits and pieces of tracking and unsuccessful tracking, unfortunately, that's going on the reserve. Everyone seems to have had a great deal of luck on Djuma today, but like I say, days like this are
days like this are gold out here because we had such huge action yesterday, of course, but because we're going into a time of great heat and it's not unpleasant to have a grey day like this because it's just a change up from what we're going to have or what we have had, certainly for the winter. You hardly see a cloud for about 3 months, and now as we go into the summer, this just will be a nice sort of relieving coolth. Andrew, keep a lookout for some leaves or buds. Marulas, I've seen one marula in leaf. I'm a little disconcerted that I haven't seen any of the knobthorns in flower yet. Should be starting by now.
I've smelt a few.
I've smelt a few, yeah.
Yeah.
But I haven't seen any. Certainly around some of the houses. So one of the landowners has planted some fever trees, which are acacias that don't naturally occur here. They occur further south of us, but they're very beautiful sort of yellow acacias, and where they've been watered they are starting to flower.
Back, and we're approaching the carcass, and apologies, it seems like there's some signal gremlins where James is, so there are some vultures up ahead, and they were on the ground. Some of them have taken off. Hopefully we will still catch one or two on the ground. As we sneak in to the buffalo carcass, decided to come back and have a look in case the hyenas might have decided that it was safe now. We'll see that the buffalo has got some new markings since we were last here, and you can see that there is vulture dung on the buffalo that wasn't there when we were here a little bit earlier. Definitely getting quite smelly. As we've chatted about a bit, the only reason I think that the Birmingham boys would have left so much meat on the carcass is because they would have heard the Matimbas or even possibly other lions, and they've headed that way to go sort them out. And that's to no means, they might definitely come back to this carcass. It is unlikely, but there is a possibility. But the wonderful thing about this is it is going to give us quite a lot of action with vultures and hyenas and other things, so very, very interesting. It is quite smelly, so I'm gonna move away a little bit and head down towards the Djuma Waterhole. Lots and lots of flies. I'm quite sure a fair amount of maggots already in that carcass. It's been a relatively quiet sunrise safari. It has been quite interesting. I have to wonder where the Birminghams have gone now. What could have spurred them to dart off in the night and head towards the south? I definitely think, the last report of the Matimbas was in that area. So maybe the Matimbas decided to find their vocals last night and the Birminghams decided to respond. Lots of vultures,
tree up ahead. So there we go. A very African scene. The vultures in a dead tree. And the reason vultures like to land in dead trees most of the time is because they're so big, and dead trees don't have too many branches. So much easier for them to land there and take off from there, which they might do as we go a little bit closer. Let's see if we can get Wium a nice vulture flying shot. Sidle up. These three less perturbed than the others. Oh, as I say that, see, that is the one unfortunate thing about being in a dead tree. Sometimes the branches can't really hold your weight. So guys, it's been a very interesting, as I said, sunrise safari. Unfortunately, not quite the cat day we had yesterday, but hopefully Scott and James will be able to find you some cats on the sunset safari. And I'm going to be heading off for a few days, but don't worry, I'll be back before the end of the week. I'm just going to go off and see my family for my birthday, and then I'm going to go fishing for a day or two up in the mountains around a place called Delstrom. So exciting times, well, for me anyway, to go fishing. And it's going to be good to be back when I do get back, and obviously I'm going to miss having you all on the back of the vehicle with us. And we're going to just meander a little bit further down the road now, and just in case something is at the Wiatilla Dam, I don't think so, and maybe you guys could even tell me, checking that, oh well, it doesn't look like I'm going anywhere. We are going nowhere, so well, we're going to sit right here. I'm going to jump up quickly, and even if I wanted to go somewhere, it seems like Djuma is not letting me leave, and says, no, you have to stay, you're on the bush, you can't go away now. And we'll see if Wium and I can fix that a little bit later. Hopefully we can, otherwise we've got to walk home. Fortunately, it's not too long a walk, or we'll just get James to come give us a lift. Oh. So thank you very much for joining us this morning on the Sunrise Safari. As I said, unfortunately not quite a cat a day, but still really, really interesting. And unfortunately James doesn't seem to have radio comms, so I can't even call him for a lift. But so I'm going to say goodbye for James and Andrew, and from Wium and myself here, thanks very much for joining us. We really appreciate the questions, and have a fantastic rest of your weekend.